I am resurrection and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall live, even though he die. And everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awaking, he will raise me up, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see, and my eyes behold him, who is my friend and not a stranger. For none of us has life in himself, and none becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord, and if we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray. God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Russell. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the Wisdom of Solomon. The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be an affliction. And their going from us to be their destruction, but they are at peace. For though in the sight of men they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Having been disciplined a little, they will receive great good because God tested them and found them worthy of himself. Those who trust in him will understand truth, and the faithful will abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are upon his elect, and he watches over his holy ones. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from 1 John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you all to stand as we sing the special arrangement of My Shepherd Will Supply.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself. And where I go to prepare a place for you, that is where I will. You will also be. And you know the way where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father but by me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
My parish in Orlando in 2014, interim rector. And I was blessed to serve alongside a priest who I consider to be one of the best all-around priests I know. There was an announcement in the Diocese of Central Florida that I'd like to share with you, because I think it perfectly sums up who Bishop Russell is. It said, "Bishop Russell Jacobus, affectionately known as Bishop Russ, will be remembered for his superb pastoral care, fun sense of humor, flair for liturgy, skilled leadership, and passion for Jesus." That was Bishop Russ. He had it all. Now, of course, we expect our priests and bishops to be perfect, right? To be great preachers, excellent pastoral care and administration. Well, the truth is, we're all human. And it's rare to find those qualities in one person. But Russ was good at it all. Often during a church staff meeting, we discuss some new plan or concept that we wanted to do. And within an hour after the meeting, there'd be a draft of that in my mailbox. Parish administration was his strength. And Bishop Russ was a consummate pastoral caregiver. If he knew you were in need, he was quick to offer prayer and support right there on the spot. Pastoral care, check. And Bishop Russ was a great preacher, gifted with the ability to relate all of the scripture for a given day into a sermon. Sometimes I ask for help on mine as well. But as important as those qualities may be, and they are, was how he made you feel when you were in his presence. I think that is what I would like to talk about. He clearly was an excellent, faithful minister of Christ and his church. But Bishop Russ touched a whole lot of lives, and he is greatly missed. Bishop Russ did have a delightful sense of humor. And my wife and I were blessed to become fast friends with Bishop Russ and his wife, Jerry. While he was interim, my wife and I were planning our wedding. One Sunday after church, we took Bishop Russ and Jerry out for lunch. And during that lunch, we invited them to go on our honeymoon. For honeymoon cruise in Europe. Well, Bishop Russ got that twinkle in his eye. And if you know Bishop Russ, you know what I'm talking about. And he put his arm behind his back. And he said, "Oh, twist my arm." Well, they did go on our honeymoon. They were the honeymoon photographers. And so began what would become a beautiful, wonderful friendship that included many European cruises. With the last one ending less than a month ago, Bishop Russ's humor was always on display. And during one of those river cruises, we had, through Germany, we stopped in a little German city and picked up some hors d'oeuvres to share that night on the deck of the riverboat. Well, when I suggested getting a baguette of bread, he protested, "Oh, we won't be able to eat a whole baguette." "Of course not, it'll get stale." Well, we did finish that baguette. And that became our little joke. A whole baguette? Detail. Detail was a byword for Bishop Russ. He planned this funeral, by the way, in detail. When we would plan a trip to Europe, he would look at all of the options, all of the excursions, all of the places to eat. He'd print it all out and then put it in a three-ring binder with colored tabs for the different sections. He was a master at detail. Now, a classic Bishop Russ line was, "I know." You remember that? "I know." When you said something obvious, you'd say, "I know. Sure it's cold out. I know." Bishop Russ and I became best friends. We loved professional football. He, a Green Bay Packers fan, obviously, and me, a Denver Broncos fan. Well, Sunday was the last, the two teams played each other. And we would text back and forth as we always did on game day. And some kind of a miracle Denver actually won. So, you know, as I think about today, all things considered, this day would be unbearable if we didn't know the rest of the story. The loss of this man is so profound and difficult that we have to take comfort in the knowledge that heaven has one more saint waiting for us when we make our final journey. You see, life doesn't end, but rather it's changed. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in me. The setting of this gospel that we just heard is in the upper room. Jesus has told his disciples that he would soon suffer and die. His friends were troubled and feeling a sense of impending loss. Jesus reassures his friends in the midst of their sorrow. And that is the Lord's message for us as well today. Jesus is telling us, let not your hearts be troubled. And along with that, he's telling us the reasons why. He's saying, let not your hearts be troubled, for there's a place I'm preparing for you. He's saying, let not your hearts be troubled, for there is a peace I am giving you. A place and a peace from Jesus. And when he says, let not your hearts be troubled, he meant that death is not the end of life, but rather a change in direction on our journey to a greater and more glorious, never-ending life. We can take comfort in knowing that Jesus has prepared a place for Bishop Russ. And now he waits on the other side for us. Russ heard the words of Jesus and believed. And so we know where Russ is today. He's not in that coffin. And he's not in a better place. He's in the best place. The place where Jesus has gone to prepare for us and for us. And that is a beautiful promise. And yet this promise doesn't ease our sadness or the reality of our loss. Our grief is real. Our loss is real. Our love for us and his love for us is real. Our grief is normal and natural, but ultimately heals. We grieve, though, with a hope and a promise. It's a promise that God watches over you. And through the grace and love of God, he comes alongside of you to hold you up, to bind up your broken heart, and to comfort you as you mourn. In time, God's peace will prevail, and our memories of Bishop Russ will once again shine as bright as the stars in the sky. And the great thing about your love for Russ is that it doesn't come to an end with death. Love reaches beyond death. And this is the good news of our Christian faith, the power of salvation, the promise of resurrection and eternal life, and that nothing, not even death, can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to God. And nothing, nothing can separate us from him, not even death. For death is not really the end at all for the Christian. It's just a door that we must pass through, a door we label death, to enter a new and larger dimension of life with God. When someone dies or when we face our own death, we need to remember that. Remember that God loves us and God is on both sides of the grave. And nothing can separate us from him. Russ knows that. Russ knew where he was going. And he knew that death is not the end. We know that just as Jesus lives, so does Russ. We can take real comfort in the promise of Jesus that he has gone and prepared a place for Russ, and that Russ now waits on the other side for us. This is what we've been promised by Jesus. There's a story I've told before that really rings true for me, and maybe you've heard it from somewhere. It's about an old country doctor that made his rounds in a horse-drawn carriage. And the doctor's dog would go along. One day, the doctor went to a home to visit one of his patients, a man who was seriously ill. "How am I, doc?" asked the man. The doctor replied, "Well, it doesn't look good." Both men were quiet for a while. Then the man said, "What's it like to die, doc?" The old doctor sat there trying to think of some words of comfort for the man. Suddenly, the answer came from a scratching at the door. The doctor said, "You hear that? That's my dog. He's never been in this house before. He has absolutely no idea what's on the other side of that door. But he knows only one thing. He knows his master is in there. And because of that, he knows everything will be all right." "Now," said the doctor, "death is like that. We've never been there before, and we don't know what's on the other side of the door. But what we do know is that our master, Jesus, is there. And that's all we really need to know. Because he is there, we can be assured that everything will be all right." In just a few minutes, we're going to share in a Thanksgiving feast called the Eucharist, or the Holy Communion. In the words of the great Thanksgiving prayer, we will say that we are joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven. That means, quite literally, that Russ and all those whom we love and see no longer will be joining us in the feast, but just on the other side of the veil. So though we grieve the loss of our beloved Russ, we know that through the grace of God, Russ will join us in the Eucharistic feast. And we know that God's love for us was manifest in his Son, Jesus Christ. We know that he cares for us. He has conquered death. He has gone before us and prepared a place for us. He is there, and that's all we really need to know. Amen.
Amen.
in the assurance of eternal life given at baptism, let us proclaim our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died in his grave. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Almighty God, you have knit together your elect in one community of fellowship, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant to your whole church in paradise and on earth your life and peace.
Amen.
Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that the grave and gate of death we may pass with him to be our joyful resurrection.
Amen.
Grant to us who are still on our pilgrimage and who walk yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days.
Amen.
Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind.
Amen.
Grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your fatherly care, that casting all their grief on you, they may know the consolation of your love.
Amen.
Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a reasonable and holy hope, in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love.
Amen.
Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of life everlasting.
Amen.
Grant us grace to entrust Russell to your never-failing love. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and remember him according to the favor which you bear unto your people.
Amen.
Grant that increasing in knowledge and love of you, he may go from strength to strength in the life of perfect service in your heavenly kingdom.
Amen.
Grant us, with all those who have died in the hope of the resurrection, to have our consummation and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory. And with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Paul, and all your saints, to receive the crown of life which you promised to all who share in the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Jerry and the rest of the Jacobus family on behalf of the community of the cathedral and Diocese of Fondland. Welcome. Especially welcome to those who are from outside the Diocese of Fondland. We're glad you're here to honor the life and legacy of Bishop Jacobus. I don't have any other instructions really, except maybe the dean has some instructions to give. Actually, let me just say this. We already heard a sermon. I promise I won't preach. But I said this to Jerry and our family after Russ. I know, enough, having been a rector and now a bishop for a while, that any time you take on a position of leadership, the shape of your job is very much determined by your predecessor. And I have been blessed, both as a priest, as a rector, but especially as a bishop, to have followed a very good bishop who was a very good steward of the community of the Diocese of Fond du Lac, and to inherit that goodness put me a mile ahead of a lot of my colleague bishops. So I'm particularly grateful for his ministry and his legacy, and particularly sorry that he's not with us anymore in the flesh. But we rejoice that he is in larger life and we just pray for him to spend. Patrick?
Like the bishop, I will avoid the desire to preach. I'd like to welcome you all to the cathedral today, and I wanted to let you know a couple of things. In a moment, we will receive an offering that will be divided between a Jacobus Diocesan Continuing Education Fund for clergy and the cathedral's media fund. And as you can well tell by the use of our sound system today, we need it. Secondly, I would say that all baptized Christians, regardless of your denomination, are invited to the table to receive the Holy Mysteries today. We would invite those who are able to come forth and to receive at the altar rail. If you would like, those who have mobility issues or do not want to climb stairs for any other reason, we will have a station over here by the Mary Shrine. If you would help us by turning down the crossing aisle right there and coming along the side so that we can commune you, and then we will ask you to go back. If you haven't been baptized, we have a font. We will help you out by the time the service is over. However, my dear friends, if you haven't been baptized, we invite you to come forward and to receive a blessing from one of the priests. Simply cross your arms over your chest, and we would be happy to do that. Finally, if you would prefer a gluten-free wafer, we would ask you to hold your hands upside down until the wafer is placed in your hand. That way we will know that you would prefer a gluten-free wafer. Thank you all, dear family. God bless you. Thank you for giving us the privilege of saying an appropriate goodbye to a godly bishop with whom in his time pleased the Lord.
I'm sorry, one other announcement. There is a luncheon after the funeral service, and it's just down the street, a couple of blocks down Division, on the corner of Division and Main Street, the Retlaw Restaurant. So you can walk down there, you can drive down there whichever way, but there is a luncheon, and everybody's invited to come and join and celebrate together a feast after the feast. And then if I may, one other, we're gonna have a station here. If it just starts to get too long up here and you can make this area, but you don't wanna wait in a long line, you can go over there as well, just for the flow. Let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
A good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For your faithful people, O Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask for your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that in the great love you have fed us with spiritual food, the drink of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be to us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, neither sorrow nor crying, but the fullness of joy with all your saints, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Of mankind, and we are mortal, born of earth, and to earth we shall return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
Give rest, O Christ, to your servant and your saints, who are sorrowing in the name of our own Lord, by the sign of the life everlasting.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Russell. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light.
Amen.
Thank you.
Our cup is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Bishop.